Welcome back, Hordlings, to more Divinity Original Sin. Alright, so I think we've pretty much done what we need to do down here in the catacombs. I'll return back the way I came. So I don't want to get ahead of myself. So yeah, we found a sheep's corpse in there. A sisal pie. Buried with its owner. You'd think I learned my lessons after digging up people's graves, but I haven't. I totally didn't know you were in that grave, Nemris.
Greetings.
Do you mean to trounce in here brandishing that thing? For the love of Seven, sheath your weapon. No hard feelings, it was just that I much prefer to face a fellow without the threat of losing my ghastly head.
Greetings.
Look here, even a sage and author is renowned as I and flattered when mortals dare among the dead to seek him out. Well, here I am, Nemris the Wise. You may go wide-eyed with amazement now. You're an author? Oh, I've written so many celebrity treatises, but of course you have read the revered Philosophy of Death. The diamond in the crown that is my literary legacy. There isn't a civilized soul alive that hasn't perused its profound pages, percolating with perspicacity. Alas, that so few show an understanding of my words, so few show the expected intellectual growth when I put them to the test. Can I read your Philosophy of Death? You can indeed, you must, but alas, I was not buried with the printed version of that blueprint of genius that is my intimately esteemed essay. Never fear though, for each and every library in Rebellion boasts a copy, the gilded cherry on their paper pie. Put me to the test. Do you truly feel you're ready to prove that you've read and understood the Philosophy of Death? Nope, not at all! Your refusal speaks greater volumes than my 10-part tome of the mating behavior of fellow dwarves. You dread the test. You fear it. Tell me about yourself, you crazy ghost! As if I need an introduction. Nemris the thinker, the theorist, the visionary. Come now, surely you lack the time as I do for such silly questions.
Farewell.
Maybe I got your book here. I stole a whole shit ton.
May the Seven keep you.
He who smelt it, dealt it. It may take some practice, but once you've got your iron bar out of your iron ore, you can make it into stronger by turning it into steel, that's right. All you need is a forge, an iron bar, and some craftsmanship, of course. Can't learn that from reading the book. Fun with fluids. If you've ever tried consuming a Gwynpenia mushroom, you know full well what matter of effect it will have. Most Revelion mushrooms have some sort of effect on the human body, and their essence can be squeezed into potions, enhancing their effects. Combining mushroom-based potions has similar effects. Pirate's life. Oh, 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 pirate's life for me. The book's tight binding belies its age. Bits of crumbling pages stick to your fingers as you turn each page.
Ew, sticky pages!
A pirate's life, shipmate Falkerson's diary. Whoever came upon the idea to go hunting for treasure in Sisal should be keyholed. I cared nothing for diaries before we ended up in this accursed place. As I fear the end is nigh, I feel obliged to warn my fellow pirates. Avoid Sisal. As sunny as its beaches are, as golden as the sun shines its cobblestone roads, equally corrupt is this hellhole. There are laws for everything in Zyseal, and every law contradicts the other. In the beginning, we tried to work alongside the system for some time better to ease down the local suspicions, you see, but I fear every trader that sets foot in Zyseal must become a pirate or an outlaw, whether they realize it or not. They're taxing on to docking a ship. They're taxing on owning a ship. They're taxing on docking without a ship. There are taxes on boarding and unboarding the ship. But one cannot unboard without having boarded in Zyseal first. Aye, what does it even mean? There are taxes on entering the tavern if you're not Zycelian. And there's a law against entering the tavern if you ain't Zycelian. Unaware, you enter and pay the tax and then get thrown into jail when the locals realize your anchor's set elsewhere. But that's not the worst part. We came here looking for treasure. There's a skull-shaped cave on the beach, and Captain is certain there's a pirate bounty within. We have sent out a dozen of our best men a fortnight ago, but they've yet to return. The rumor amongst our men is that the cave is haunted. Yogwash! The rest of us will investigate tomorrow if our crew has not returned. Then it's goodbye, Zyseal. Due to Anus' qualities are many and well documented. For an adventure, it isn't wise to consume the thick of battle, though recreational use it widely accepted amongst liberal circles. Knowledge sufficiently westwildly spread, however, in that Jonah Dane is the best consumed in a flask, as the bottling process often brings out its finest features. He who smelted Volume 1, the quality of a proper sword has quite declined in the recent decades. Some blame the change in climate, others change in the type of origin of iron reserves. I myself craft my own supplies from an iron bar and an anvil to ensure the maximum character of a weapon. Alright, well, we don't have the book we're searching for. And we can identify that because, guess what? It's got to be done by Ronstar.
Rest in peace, darling.
Shut your mouth, Hooker. Armor rating 8, fire resistance. I thought I put this... Oh, that's right. Armor specialist plus 1. So actually even a little bit better.
Greetings.
The music is kick-ass in this game.
Tell me about yourself, Siva.
I once lived a prosperous life with my husband and our happy little daughter, Loni.
Oh, we already hear this story.
Bye.
Let's dig that bitch up.
I don't have the right tool for digging.
But look's got it. Move out the way.
Keep you. Back from there, savage. Disturb my daughter's peace.
I'm gonna serve a lot more than her peace.
Alright, we're not gonna do that, because we can do a quest for her, I think.
And then I'm gonna cut that bitch in half.
I'm gonna be somewhat good in this game, because I don't want to break anything like I've been doing in Baldur's Gate. I just awoke the fucking Grim Reaper, Helen. Two action points, not enough.
Thank you.
Hell yeah, I got, you got smoked, Helen.
Here lies Helen, killed by an enraged zombie. I'm sure we can talk this out.
She got killed by an enraged zombie and then turned into an enraged zombie. But hell, she was worth 300 experience. Where I come from, that's a good thing. Ooh. Nice. A couple of you have been commenting that you're really glad that I'm taking my time and searching everything and really developing the game and involving myself as if I'm not really recording it and I'm just taking my leisurely time. And I appreciate you guys and gals that don't mind me just having fun with it. No rush. Constitution 1. Ooh, Lugla can use that. Also, send that to Lug. He is the treasurer. That gives him a pretty decent bonus of hit points, 66 to 192.
Lug like hit points!
Find this Undertaker.
Those boots would bar us a bridge troll. Get you shiny.
Sorry, sir.
Greetings. These stores are for our legion troops. Rivalon's finest work up might be fine.
Yeah. Cook's house. Triangle in there.
Here lies Neil, killed in the line of duty. Here lies Judith, warrior princess. Here lies Clay.
Probably backers.
Here lies Jack. Shall I come back as an enraged spirit? Or as a lovable prankster ghost?
I suppose.
I'm not sure. Let's find out as I dig open your grave, Jared.
Rest in peace, darling.
What the fuck? What the shit is that? I don't think we want to be near that dude. That's not good. All right. That little prick.
Peace, darling.
There's an eyeball, an apple, a torso, an axe, and a giant match, it looks like. Oh.
Here lies Jared. Shall I come back as an enraged spirit or as a lovable prankster ghost?
Came back as an enraged skeleton with a bulbous head. Talk to Eglanda.
Greetings.
Oh, how nice it is of you. The very picture of you to break the monotony of Enelda's day.
Whiled away on this hardwood bench.
Pray, let me be forward with you. O sapling rose, O leaf of spring, for my weary mind is troubled and would highly prize thy gentle-handed assistance, thy kind ministrations.
Ministrations, huh? Tell me more about yourself, old man.
I am but an aged elf that has seen the years parade in long succession. Gladly shall I tell you more. Will I regale thee, O whelp of men, with my tale, but not here, where the winds may steal my words.
About the assistance you asked of me.
You would listen to my grievances, guide me toward untroubled realms. You truly are a wonder, a budding flower of the morn, yet that which I would tell you of is a rather private nature, so let us escape both the chill and the eye of the public scrutiny. Hot spiced wine in a snug little room await us in the King Crab's first floor. Let us go there so we can warm our bones, yet make shiver our hearts with a tale of loss and sorrow.
Huh? I'm not getting in any room with you by myself. I know a guy Dorno. Perhaps you two would get along.
Where the fuck is this Undertaker guy? The Corpse Compendium. Mortician, right there he is.
Haha, I found you. Let me search your crates first.
Empty, empty. I love the shift search command. Very cool. Ooh, a guitar. You know the GameHorder has that guitar. It's the only way he'll ever write a Divinity song. I don't see anyone around. I think that means this book is free.
If only the popular girls from the Source Academy could see how edgy and dangerous you've become.
That is my shorts talking, by the way. That is my Zandalore's trunks. They like to be snarky. It's kind of like my sword in Baldur's Gate 2 that likes to talk a lot of shit. The Corpse Compendium could have good information. The Second Life Death Rites and Rituals Among the Seven Races, Volume 1's Imps and Orcs. Whoa, shit. Chapter 1 ends. In all cases, the disposal of preservation of the imp corpse is left to the discretion of their masters. Typically, imps are simply burned with the evening's refuse or buried alongside the dead pets of the master they served. In rare cases, especially obedient or well-loved imps will be given traditional death rites according to the imp's master race.
The master race, the Aryans.
In the case of embalming, imps pose no special problems. In fact, they require rather less formaldehyde than a typical man-elf or dwarf.
Chapter 2, Orcs.
Though their practices may appear savage to the untrained eye, death inspires a complex and sometimes beautiful aspect of orcish culture. According to the common orcish religion, Amun Hor, the old mother, receives souls of the dead, thus death is typically celebrated, not mourned. The dead's corpse is buried immediately, and beautiful totems or other relics are erected atop the grave. These are meant to please the All-Mother when she comes for the spirit of the dead. Next, the tribe members, from toddlers to elders of the queen included, form a great ring, and each by each relate the cherished memory of the deceased. Thus, the life and the passing of the deceased are recalled with joy and excitement. However, if they are caught mourning dead in words or by tears, the punishment is death. For surely any who would mourn the passing of a soul to the All-Mother is a traitor and disbeliever. Interesting concept.
Greetings!
So, what's the bad news? More orcs rampaging through the docks, or have those infernal statues set another soul flying to the death?
Tell me about yourself! Guy with cloth bracers and a hammer. Hammer and nails.
This here's my family business, yes. There's been a Roberts escorting stiffs into the next life since the foundation of Cyseal itself. They don't write epics about morticians, but I'm proud of my work nonetheless.
What can you tell me about Jake's murder?
Sad story that, though if I'm speaking plainly, the sentimental aspect of it all doesn't make much of an impression on an undertaker, especially not these days with so many laid low by orcs and such like. I just concerned myself with giving the remains a respectable exit from life. We set him to rest in the northern graveyard. Perhaps he can finally get a little peace.
About Jake's body?
A sheep? That's a whole heap of nonsense. Don't bother me with such wild ideas.
I'll tell you what. You tell me the truth about that sheep, and I won't bother burying you alongside it.
Hopefully that's before. Oh, now this motherfucker's gonna cheat. Not doing good. No, he's a fucking scissorer. All he knows to do is just scissor.
And Stake got you again!
You're a fucking asshole. So what do you do if you fail the test and you don't save? It resets it at least. No, I've been tied somebody. Ah. He wouldn't choose rock three times in a row.
He would choose paper! I am the victor. God bless you, Quicksave.
Come on now, there's no need for all that then. I'll tell you the story as best as I know it. I buried that blasted sheep, but I swear on my lucky left foot I had nothing to do with the body disappearing. One minute it was on my slab, you see. I left the room for just a moment to answer that bell in the front parlor, and when I returned, the body was simply gone. In its place was a sack containing more gold coins than I could even count. The message was clear. Silence is golden.
My business has been declining right alongside the rest of our blighted city, and that sack of gold was worth more than I had made during one of the good years. I needed cash, and someone needed my silence. I knew I had to bury something or risk being found out, so that night I stole into the market and made off with Bert as fat as sheep. It was a bloody waste to stick so much fine meat into the ground to rot, but it had to be done. The next day, the pallbearers retrieved Jake's coffin, sealed to hide the body's terrible wounds, none the wiser that within the casket lay nothing more vulnerable than a slaughtered beast. Now you can imagine I've spent more than my share of restless nights wondering who could have wanted the cadaver and what for purpose. I am not an inch closer to imagining the why, but I have a few inklings as to the who. Near as I can reckon, there are only four people who could have been involved. Mayor Cecil, Captain Aureus, Thaleron's apprentice Evelyn, and Esmeralda.
Why do you suspect Mayor Cecil?
Plenty of us shopkeepers entrust the mayor with our spare keys to our business, you know? And he's the only person in town with a second copy of the key to the mortuary. He could have used it to sidle in with a peep, if he was so inclined.
What about Captain Aureus?
Aureus paid himself a visit to me the night the body was delivered, came rapping at my door in the frosty morning before the sun even started peeping, and told me to tell him, and only him, if I noticed anything strange or suspicious about the remains. Can't see why he'd bother to go through all the trouble unless he knew something the rest of us don't.
What about Evelyn?
I know it sounds strange suspecting the doctor's apprentice of something so ghoulish as this, but there's few in the city could manage to transport a corpse without raising eyebrows. If it was she who delivered Jake's body from the inn in the mortuary, and there was something about her that night, some kind of excitement. Seems she could barely contain her thoughts, and there was some thrilling about to happen. I can't quite settle it in my mind how a young medical professional would have such a strange reaction to an occasion such as that. And this may or may not have anything to do with the old rigmarole, but her master, Dr. Thaleron, bought an old shack of mine, one overtaken by undead, for an exorbitant price considering what he was getting. I never did figure what he wanted it for, but he sure did seem eager.
What about Esmeralda?
I never saw a widow less distraught at the death of her husband, and I've seen hundreds pass through my parlor. It was she who rang my bell just before the body was snatched, lured me outside claiming she needed air before discussing the funeral's arrangement. Some accomplice could have sneaked in and grabbed the remains while I was comforting the oh-so-overcome Esmeralda.
About that bag of gold you received for keeping quiet about Jake's body.
The gold's the only good thing to come with this blasted affair, and I certainly plan on making some use of it.
Surely Bergia, whose sheep you stole, deserves this money more than anyone. Hand over the gold so we can make its way to the rightful owner. Actually, I suggest you give it to me. Oh, I can quick save. Paper covers rock, asshole. Scissors cut your flimsy paper. What'd I tell you about paper the first time, ding-a-ling? You rockhead! Flawless victory!
Look, there's no need for all that. Take the gold then. We'll call the rest even, okay?
Bye!
Okay! Now I'm gonna cut you in half!
Let's see, a year's worth of gold. How much did I get? Doesn't look like that much. Thank you. All right. Yeah, we need to confront either the Duke or Esmeralda or both about that. Some nonsense.
Source abominations trotting about.
Crazy hooker. Esmeralda.
Greetings.
Whoa. Summon Fire Elemental Scroll. To go straight rich. $448. I'll take the gold for now. So much shit.
Lords above, grant me patience. Your souls are not you here because you think I killed my husband. How many times do I need to state that and restate my complete innocence in the matter?
Let's discuss your husband's murder, then.
Like I told you and every legionnaire in town, I don't know anything about poor Jake's murder. I want his killer found and tried, but everyone suspects me for this evil deed, and you're no different, are you? So, what happened? Some tilly-tally crab chasers down the pub called me a murderous gold digger, and you believe them? This insinuations truly go beyond the pale. Oh, I think I'm getting one of my headaches.
This love letter seems kind of incriminating.
Oh, don't put stock in the hastily scribbled words of a lovelorn fool. This letter, it was the show of a passion, a poorly worded passion. I did not echo in the least. The Duke, he's like a spoiled child. He's not a man. He's not like Septimus.
Who are you?
I'm Esmeralda, the wife of Jake, and now alas, his widow. Poor man, we were both so young when we married. He's so rich and I so poor, but his one and only princess just the same.
Tell me about this place.
What do you want to know?
Undead?
Sometimes I forget they're even out there, to be honest. Remember, above all, to stay behind the wall, we tell our children.
I've heard it before.
She seems to be quite adamant about her innocence.
We'll need to look for evidence if we want to prove she actually did the evil deed.
Okay. Is that like a hint to break into her bedroom?
Where do you sleep, hooker?
Smelly panties? Give them.
Why is she keeping those on hand, anyhow? Sentimental pieces.
I straight love smelly panties. Need to see me going in here. Thank you. She's got a book called The Perfect Murder.
Esmeralda. That's not incriminating. Has an interesting taste in literature.
So you basically get a warning for committing an act of crime in front of the guards or the person. Locked.
If only the popular girls from the Source Academy could see how edgy and dangerous you've become.
Cellar too. Kicking another's bucket, planning the perfect murder by Mr. Giggles. Winner of the Assassin's Guild Brass Knuckle Award. So you've determined to take a life. My sincerest congratulations. Savor this moment, friends. Taste the sweetness of the feeling that grows in your belly. Soon you'll have sent a soul flying into the aether. Your hand alone will have caused the fabric of existence to have undergone a permanent and undeniable change. You are preparing to undertake the most exquisite endeavor of your life, and you'd be remiss not to luxuriate in every surrounding moment. Selecting your target, there are several questions to consider when determining which life is best to seize. The following are but a few. Is the head of your intended victim sufficiently round and symmetrical to make an impressive mounted trophy? Does he or she have hair sufficient length and health to spin it to lovely yawn for darning socks or throw rugs? Will his or her hide provide a supple shoes, bags, and belts of a color that suits your eyes? Choosing a modus operandi. Selecting the method in which to carve, strangle, or pierce your victim is in itself more a matter of art in the soul than a fact of science. Arrows are fine for supportive types. Sportive type. Dagger turns the carpet red as the Valentine. Suffocation behooves lovers and mothers. Poison complements a bitter heart. In the end, select a method you believe best accomplishes the moral and spiritual effects you desire. The most important and delectable step in any murder, dear reader, is the moment of execution. By this, I do not mean the brute force of the violence, if a violent method you have chosen, or the interim ever agonizing between the administration of poison and the first sign of its effects. No. The moment to which I refer is the precise event when life flees from the victim and the eyes transfigure. Light to dark, flashing to still, bright to dumb. This is the holy minute, the minute when the act materializes, complete, no longer planned or attempted, but completed. This is the moment during which you write your name in the sky, for you have done something that, like the stars, cannot be undone. The afterglow. Now the moments after the execution are hardly the time to worry about your practicalities. No! This is the time to quietly reflect, to enjoy your transformed self, your transformed place within the cosmos. Make yourself a cup of tea, if you please, or light a pipe. The details can wait.
When you find yourself fully refreshed, you might consider what to do with once the person who remains. You must now inter or preserve, as is your pleasure. The easiest and most classical means of disposal, of course, is to bury the remains, but think long and hard about precisely which remains to bury. The civilized among us know full well that the waste is sure a sin. If there is yet some function that may be wrought from the one person's remain, it's imperative that you do so. Might not the family of beggars appreciate a meaty rack of ribs? Might lock a local tanner down on his luck, thank you for a length of virgin leather. Do you not deserve some special token, a keepsake, for your labors? Once these matters have been attended to, you might concern yourself with removing the dregs of your effort from your sight. A freshly rained upon bog is ideal, though a freshly dug grave in your local cemetery will hardly notice a bit of additional rubbish tucked in below the intended casket. If you successfully completed your endeavor, you might find yourself wondering after and planning for the next. This is the natural and desirable result of executing, as you have learned, the perfect murder. The author wishes you luck and satisfaction as you explore your newfound passion. Remember, until you've reached a dozen, you've hardly scratched the surface. And on that note, folks, I leave the rest to you, and we'll see you shortly with more Divinity Original Sin. Thanks for watching, and good night.
Boom shakalaka, boom fucking shakalaka.